Trash.
Welcome to another episode of It's All Trash, a podcast diving into the trash world of education. My name is Sabrina Alicea. I am a lifelong educator, and today I am joined by a former law school student and viral tweet author, Stacey Menjivar. Stacey, I'm so excited to have you on the show today. How are you feeling?
I'm excited to be here. I'm feeling good. I just moved to DC, lots of heavy lifting, so all the dopamine flowing.
All right, good. Well, I like to start off the show by doing a little check-in. So a glow and a grow. What are you carrying with you today?
Oh, gosh. I'm trying to grow away from the internet for a couple of days so that things can settle down. This is actually the first time in 2 days I've opened my laptop.
Okay.
And for my glow, I guess I'll jump back into bar studying so that I can glow up one day.
Yes, I love that. You're gonna have to explain that process, like, when we get more into your story, because I'm always confused about it, and I think Legally Blonde does a disservice to the law world. Okay. So my glow and grow, my glow is that I've been, like, trying to get really good at budgeting. I know this sounds like very adult thing, but I was budgeting and I'm looking at the month of June, which is almost over. And this is like the month that I've actually spent the least amount of mad money. So I'm doing good. I'm like really happy with my savings. My grow is that it's been hot in Chicago. You were in Chicago for a little bit, right?
I was. It was not that hot, but it was still quite toasty.
Yeah, it's getting up there these days. And this is the first time in a very long time that I've living without, like, central air. So I have, like, window units, but it's an adjustment because you have to wake up and you're like, do I put the unit on? Do I not? So I've been having this, like, you know, glowy stage in my skin of adjusting to being in the heat. So it's not the end of the world, but the AC should be fixed, you know, soon-ish. And I'm praying for that. That's my girl. Which also could be my glow, because my skin has been really, really
That's the secret.
Yeah, that's the secret. No AC.
Yeah.
So we also like to go into some trash and treasure current events. There's lots of trash in the current event world, right?
Lots of trash, this week especially.
Yes. So do you want to start with a good thing or a bad thing? What do you want to start with?
Let's just, you know, rip the Band-Aid off. Let's do the bad.
Yeah, so we got to talk about Roe versus Wade. What are your thoughts?
We do. Still processing. Legally, it makes zero sense, which has happened, because this is, you know, a constitutional right that 50 years ago we determined was essential for women to live the lives that we expect them to live. And now all of a sudden the court is different, the opinions have changed, and it's no longer a fundamental right, which is obviously for our generations, it's the first time this has happened. Obviously there are people alive who were alive for the entirety of Roe before it was repealed. And so I'm curious as to what they think and what they think of the past 50 years and how they advise kind of the movement to go forward, knowing that the Supreme Court is very conservative and will be for who knows how long. What else can we do, I guess, to target the states, since clearly the federal government is not, it's not where it's at right now.
Mm-hmm. I feel very much the same way. I'm also trying to process and wrap my head around a lot of different aspects of it. Like, my baseline is that it's just crappy, shitty, like, it's horrible that it was taken away. But when I'm looking more into the complexities of it, I've been seeing some folks talking about how this is now going to affect IVF treatments. And I don't understand the medical or science background to that or why. So I'm trying to learn a little bit more about what that means. Then also the fact that there's, like, some states are trying to put this, like, fugitive act sort of thing into it, where if you cross state lines, like, that's really crazy next level punishment for seeking out this service. So there's just, like, a lot of layers. And I think when I was younger and things happened in the news and it was like, okay, I'm just taking it at surface level for what's going on. But now at this age, I want to know more. So I'm trying to dive in. What does it mean for IVF? What does it mean for, you know, even adoption? How is this going to impact the foster care system? How is this going to impact just humans in general, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And I just turned 30 a couple of months ago. And so this is definitely something that is affecting me and my friends. And especially now that we're, you know, going into our careers, but also choosing or not choosing to have kids. Mm-hmm. And just coming into this during this time is very crazy. But I also did just see something on Twitter about, like, you know, how many women are going to commit suicide because they cannot access abortion, how many men are going to commit murder because their, you know, partners or friends can't access abortion services, and that what that's going to mean for their lives. And so I think we're going to start fleshing out all of these, you know, these other changes that will happen and consequences that will happen as a result of this decision.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think the one of the statements that hits the nail on the head with this is, like, you're not going to outlaw abortions, or you'll never get rid of abortions. You're just going to be banning safe abortions. That's what's going to end up happening. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's so much we can do. Obviously, you know, we could do entire podcast episode on that topic alone. When my mom was on the podcast, we talked about what her abortion, and not even that she had an abortion. I'm sorry. It was that she made an appointment to possibly have one when she got pregnant with me, because she was a teen mom, and, you know, her and my dad had agreed that that was what they were going to do. And then she decided against it. And she talked about how even having that choice made her feel like when she did end up having me, she committed to having me. It was her decision because she was allowed to make it. I wasn't forced upon her, you know, so it, and it obviously impacted our relationship in a really positive way. So it's something we could talk about forever, but I just wanted to, like, at least address it, that it's crappy, so people know how we feel.
We feel a lot.
We do feel a lot. So on a little lighter note, I had texted you before this and I was like, girl, you need to watch this J-Lo documentary.
Yeah.
And you did. What did you think of J-Lo before this documentary? Because so many people have talked about how they felt the way before and then they felt the way after. So what did you think before? What did you think after?
Well, Selena was always my favorite movie growing up. So, I knew J-Lo from Selena. I don't think that until, like, I was 10, I realized J-Lo wasn't Selena. And so, and that, like, her career came from, this movie. And so for me, she was always linked to Selena. That's always how I thought of her. And then I guess, around, like, my teenage years, she started coming out with more music, but I think this is during the time that the documentary referenced was, like, not her, you know, greatest time as a as an artist. She was all over tabloids, you know, her music wasn't all that successful, her movies weren't really, you know, making great waves. And so I think for me it was always Selena, and she'll always be Selena first and foremost for me, just because that's how I grew up. Yeah, I have so much respect for her after this documentary. I was like, if this woman is learning how to pole dance at 50, I can restart yoga. Cause sometimes I'm like, I'm too old, I can't. And now I'm like, well, I guess not. I guess J-Lo says we can.
You're never too old. I think before I watched it, I always saw J-Lo as, like, a figure that was just, she existed, right? Like, there's some there's some actors or musicians or whoever who try to get political, they try to use their voice to speak on things, and I never saw her as one of those people. And a good friend of mine, she's like, that's why I don't like her, because she only uses her Latinidad as, like, you know, a project. Like, she doesn't do anything for Latino people. That's how my friend really genuinely felt about her. And I'm like, some people should be allowed to exist like that. The problem with our world today is that it's so, or one of the problems, I guess, is that it's so political. Everybody has to make a statement because things are so crappy, but, like, we all should have the right to literally just exist. And that's what J-Lo was trying to do. But then I saw the documentary and I was like, oh no, she was very intentionally using her voice, especially in that halftime performance. Because even when it first came out, I saw, I don't know, did you watch the halftime show when it first happened?
I did,
yeah. And did you catch the Cage reference?
I did not.
I saw it and I was like, is it a Cage reference? I thought it could be, but it couldn't. And then it's like, well, knowing J-Lo, it's probably not. Like, that's really what I thought. So then watching this documentary, being like, oh no, she was super intentional. And I actually thought it was kind of dumb that her daughter was singing Born in the USA, because I thought it was like, at first I was like, I'm tired of this, like Puerto Ricans being like, we're American. And it's like, we're hanging on by a thread of Americanism. So I wasn't really into it. But then when she explained in the documentary, I'm like, okay, I get the intentionality behind it. So I thought that was really good. I definitely respect her artistry more now.
Yeah, I really appreciated the explanations for all of that. And then I think the documentary also briefly notes that she had chosen not to be political, and then came the, you know, the children and the cages, and kind of that was the straw that broke the camel's back for her. And so pitching in to say that, like, you can be apolitical, and then if something moves you to that extent, you can change the way in which you act. And she, it seems like that's exactly what she did. And obviously she used a really huge platform to convey an important message. So good for her.
Yeah. And have you seen all of the different, it's really irritating because there's lots of different like news articles that are misconstruing her words, or they're highlighting like, she said it was the worst idea in the world for her and Shakira to perform. Did you see all that? And
I didn't read that, but I remember when she first started in the documentary, when she would talk about the show, and kind, my individual interpretation was she kind of tossed Shakira to the side. And it appeared to me, just on the documentary, I have not done any further research, that she was kind of contrasting herself to Shakira. She's like, oh, yeah, we can go shake our asses, or we can like do political statement. And parts of the documentary, to me, it seemed like she was casting Shakira of this as like this vapid performer who's just going to quote unquote shake her ass, whereas she was going to actually say something important and use her platform. That was a little irritating for me, especially because we didn't hear from Shakira at all, and she was just portrayed in this way, and obviously like there's another story and we don't know what Shakira was thinking. But generally I do understand that the frustration was about how little time they were given, and another thing is like, why did they need two performers? Like, is J-Lo not enough? Is Shakira not enough? Each of them would have been fantastic on their own, and I think they could have done a wonderful show with 14 minutes individually. So I understand why J-Lo was upset, and I understand like were they the first Latina women to?
Yeah.
So it's just like, you know, they're making them, they're limiting them to the extent that they can't put out the best possible performance they can. And that obviously is going to reflect back upon, you know, oh, Latina women, you know, wasn't the best performance, but obviously they weren't given the resources.
Yeah, that's exactly what she was saying. That she was just like, no other in the history before, you pick a person, and if that person wanted to invite somebody, they would do that. But if they didn't, then that was up to them. And so it was the first time that the NFL was like, no, we need to. And then I saw another article that's, or it was from an interview. They had asked Gloria Estefan to be part of it too. And so Gloria Estefan, and she was like, can you imagine if they tried to put three of us on there? Like, you know, she was, and then the thing that irritated me was that the article was putting it as if Gloria Estefan was talking smack about J-Lo, but she wasn't. Mm-hmm. She was pointing out this, like, contradiction of what the NFL was trying to do. So I wasn't liking that, where it was like, I was seeing lots of news articles that were kind of pitting the women against each other. And I'm like, that doesn't help us either. We don't need to do all that. Yeah, that was frustrating.
That's definitely how I imagine people saw it, because she was very frustrated, but not at, you know, sharing the stage with Shakira, but just sharing the time that they don't have.
Right.
It makes me think, was the year before that when Maroon 5 performed?
I don't know, maybe.
Because it was in Atlanta, I think, and they, was it Rihanna and somebody else dropped out because something NFL racial justice related. And so I'm thinking they tried to overcompensate the following year by like getting all the Latinas and saying, hey, we're not racist, but obviously like white men made this decision and didn't really think through how it would come across. And I think we're seeing that now.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. So now we're going to get into our game. I want to spice it up a little bit, have a little fun. So this is a game where we're going to blend our worlds of law and education, okay? So I'm going to give you a bunch of different names, And you have to choose whether you would just teach this person, you would mentor them, or this could be like you mentoring them or them mentoring you know, any type of mentorship relationship, or if you would abandon them on the field trip. Now, this is the caveat that I have to put is we would never abandon a child on the field trip. We just wouldn't do that. But some of these dusty adults, we would definitely abandon on a field trip. So those are your choices. Teach, mentor, abandon on a field trip. And this is the law
Gotcha.
edition. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Our first contestant, Nancy Pelosi.
We can abandon her on a field trip.
Okay.
I feel like it's time to, move the Democratic Party in another direction.
Okay. I like that. All right, AOC.
I would like to be mentored by her.
Same. Heavy, heavy same. Love that. What about Bernie Sanders?
I would also like to be mentored by Bernie or just be his friend,
Yeah.
honestly.
He does seem like someone you could literally just hang out with and like have a good time,
Yeah.
right? Yeah. Love
I feel
that.
like he's an excellent grandpa.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh,
All right. Next, Elle Woods.
God. I don't know if I could teach her anything. What would I teach her?
I don't know.
But I also wouldn't want to be mentored by her. I mean, she did well, obviously, but like.
Right, but you wouldn't necessarily want to abandon her on a field trip either.
Yeah. Maybe we can teach her something. We'll
Okay,
find
yeah.
something to teach her.
Rudy Giuliani.
Oh God, we're abandoning him on a
We're
field trip.
abandoning. Yeah, there's lots of. We're gonna have like a bucket of folks we're just abandoning, huh? How about Meghan Markle in suits?
Rachel Zane. I would teach her how to apply to law school.
Oh,
I
well,
feel
I
like
didn't
she
even watch the
struggled.
show. Did she do bad on that?
I think like the premise of the show is everyone wants to be a Harvard lawyer, and she ended up not getting into Harvard, but she got into Stanford. She's doing fine with her life, obviously. But also got to teach her that Harvard isn't the only law school, so we'll
Okay,
teach her
there we go.
that.
We'll get into that too. I added this one for fun yesterday. Clarence Thomas.
We can abandon him anywhere because I wouldn't take him on a field trip. He needs to learn to behave before that.
He wouldn't even
You
be
can leave him
invited
at
on the
home.
field.
No.
I love
He can stay home.
that. There is always that kid. Unfortunately, it always gets to that point where you're like, you can't go on the field trip unless your parent comes with you. I've had those kids where I'm like, you're more than welcome to come, but you need a designated chaperone.
Yeah, but
Yeah.
his designated chaperone, his wife, is over here trying to add to the tyranny of January 6th.
Yeah.
So, like, no, both of them need to stay home and get like change schools,
You're absolutely
in my
right.
opinion.
All right, last but not least, Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor.
Obviously, I have nothing to teach her, but I would love to be her mentee in
Yeah.
any capacity.
I'm obsessed with Sonia. And actually, when I was applying to, when I was in the process of applying to Harvard, I was reading her book. Now, I have to say, her book, what, have you read it?
My beloved world, years ago, yes.
Yeah, so I and yeah, that was a long, oh my God, that was a long time ago when I was reading that. But it's not written in a super engaging format. It's definitely not the best narrative nonfiction I've ever read. But her story was so good, and like
Yeah.
she was born by a teen mom too. Her mom was a nurse. My mom was a nurse. She was like talking about this audacity to dream that you could get into an Ivy League school and do all of that. And so I felt such a connection to that text. It made me, I think the energy of reading it while my application was being, submitted at Harvard gave good energy to
Yeah.
the universe to get me in for sure.
Yeah, I read it toward the end of undergrad. So I think I was like nearing what I thought would be my, educational journey. And also felt like it was really dry. But I think once you're, you get a high profile appointment, I feel like you have to kind of churn the memoir out to make the most money. So I feel like perhaps her next one will be slower, and I'm sure she will have a next one
Oh,
to
yeah.
talk about what her workplace is like right now.
Yeah, that's gonna be a good one. I would definitely like to read it, but I would love for her to bring on a someone to, craft the narrative a little bit better.
Yeah, her and Michelle Obama's Becoming, which is the one I read most recently. Both of them I definitely felt connected to in terms of like being from low to middle income household, and for Sonia being an immigrant or the daughter of immigrants. And Michelle Obama went to Princeton also, and so I at the time I was there, I was a senior, and so going over like her experience and seeing, you know, how little has changed, was also very eye-opening.
Yeah, that's really, I actually have Becoming here behind me, but my mom said the same thing when she read Becoming. She was like, it was kind of slow and dry, so I just haven't picked it up yet.
Yeah, it's on my list. I think generally that's true. I think what kept it going for me was, like, she was at Princeton. Mm-hmm. When a lot of this took place at Princeton, and then at Harvard Law, so a lot of things that I had experienced slash would experience, and so I was, like, interested. But, yeah, both of them, very relatable, and just goes to show, like, two women of color release a book, and you have all these women of color, like, being able to identify themselves in their writing and their stories, and how important that is.
Yeah, absolutely. I actually, this is, like, totally unrelated, but I just watched this really great documentary on Netflix, and it was created by Gina Davis, and she has an institute that talks about women in Hollywood and this representation of women that goes into, like, directors and women directors and all of these different numbers. And it actually was able to show statistics of how certain roles that women showed on TV connected to women, like, applying for certain jobs or, like, going into certain fields. So just the idea of representation, like, if, you know, when you're seeing Viola Davis playing a lawyer, you now have this idea that you can be a lawyer, as opposed to, like, every other movie shows women as just, like, sex pots, you know?
Yeah, exactly. I was watching Suits, and I saw Meghan Markle apply to law school, and 2 years later, I did too. So even the little things like that, even though, like, by the time I had applied, she'd escaped to London and stolen a prince and come back.
You're like, I want to do that one too, right?
I'm like, that's next on my list as well. But no, it's, representation is so important, because even, like, fake characters like that, where you can identify with them and see yourself in their story, obviously, like, push some people to action, which is important.
Yeah, just being able to see yourself in that way. Well, I wanted to share with you that, like, on a very selfish note, the reason that I have you on here and your story resonated with me is because I have been so vocal in the teaching world about how I feel about student teaching. Now, our stories about, you know, the way that the student worker exploitation kind of go, they're different, but they have this similar thread of exploitation of student workers, quite honestly. And so with teaching, we go into student teaching while you're in undergrad, and you don't take any classes that entire time, or sometimes you take, like, a couple of classes. It depends on the school you're at, but really you're in the classroom, and the goal is for you to slowly transition to teaching a couple of subjects, to by the end of your student teaching, you're full-time teaching within that classroom. You're under the guidance of a mentor teacher, but you're really doing all of that work. You're lesson planning, you're doing classroom management, you're being observed, all of these different implementation strategies. And it is the full work day of a classroom, right? Yeah. So when you're student teaching, it's really, really hard to be able to get a job on top of that. You're already paying tuition, whether that's through financial aid or, like, however you figure that out. And then you really can't do other work the same way that you might have been able to when you were just in your classes. So that's student teaching in undergrad. When I was at Harvard, we had I went in for my reading specialist certificate. And with the reading specialist certificate, you were required to have 3 years of classroom experience. You were required to have an active teaching license as well. And then you took all the classes in the program. In addition to that, we partnered with local schools where we would come in and do reading specialist work. It was about 12 to 20 hours a week that you had to do that extra internship work. And then because the program at Harvard is, like, really, it's like an accelerated year, you also were taking full-time classes on top of that. There was absolutely no way that I could work in addition to doing the internship and taking all of those classes. And what would frustrate me is I'm not even talking about being paid, because your situation is talking about, like, the summer clerks get paid. What frustrated me is that we weren't even eligible for work study with those programs. So you have work study that's a part of financial aid. And some people can get, I don't know, what, like, $5,000 a semester, $10,000, depending on where you're at the school. If you can't use your work study, but you still need the money, you need to convert it to a loan, which is what I had to do every single time. So I have those now, instead of being able to work and just have that money, even though I was technically working, both of these situations, I was working when I was student teaching. I was working as an intern, which literally required 3 years of education or 3 years of experience minimum and that license, but I wasn't able to get even the basic work study with it. So I constantly felt that this was such a disrespectful policy. It's the amount of experience that we bring to the table, the amount of experience that they require. And I have just like made a commitment that I am going to like scream about this until it changes or I die, whichever happens first, which is probably going to be death. Like they're not, I don't know when these policies are going to change, especially because they work around women in the education world. So when I heard about your story and this financial exploitation that happened to you, I was like, I need to have her on the podcast. Now, I was trying to share on my story on Instagram yesterday, little bits and pieces about it so folks could get some information. But you ever seen that thing where they say, explain it to us like you're five? Yeah.
Yeah.
So explain it to all of us listening like you're five. What is this policy that you came face to face with at Harvard?
So this is, so I'm at Harvard Law School, and this financial aid policy is the summer contribution policy, okay, which in theory would apply to every student, but in practice only truly affects low-income students. So I guess to understand this, Harvard is one of the only law schools that offers need-based aid exclusively, meaning you can't get merit scholarships, you can't get a full ride from getting great SAT scores. What you can do is get in. So you get in, and then your financial aid is determined by how much money you have, by how much money you have in the bank, by, how much money Harvard thinks you need for the year, et cetera. And so a lot of low-income students like myself tend to, meet the maximum for, mm-hmm. for need-based aid. So in theory, like all the aid that Harvard could give you, I think for Harvard, it's trying to remember if there's a cap. But so the aid is need-based. And so you can only take out the loans, I suppose, or Harvard only covers some of your financial aid up to a certain point. But before you even get to the point where Harvard will give you a single grant dollar, you have to already take out $150,000 of loans before that. So there's a minimum loan requirement before Harvard's grant aid is even applicable to you. So wow. If you take out $150,000 and you still can't afford going to Harvard Law School, that's when HLS will give you grant money. The problem with this summer contribution policy is that whatever you make in the summer, and for bigger law firms, it is a lot. So you'd make about $40,000. In about 10 weeks, which is, yes, it's a lot.
Yeah.
And then Harvard takes that into its formulation when it calculates your need for the following year. So now it's saying, okay, you have $40,000 extra dollars. So you need X amount of money less from us. And so they decrease their financial aid to account for the fact that you just worked all summer and made this money. The issue is, of course, that if you're not on financial aid at all, and Harvard isn't giving you grant aid, which people my age, most likely your parents or family members paying your tuition, you are pocketing those $40,000 wow. in the summer. So you go to work, pocket the paychecks, your parents pay your tuition like usual. Now you have $40,000 to enjoy for the next year. Whereas low-income students, most of us don't have anyone to pay our tuition. And so that $40,000 is going to be used to live and to, serve a little bit as a cushion. God forbid something happens, you are able to pay, medical bills, something happens to your pet, you're able to do that, you're able to help your family a little bit. And so that is what students are not able to do. So they don't have the freedom to use that $40,000 in a way that would benefit them. Instead, Harvard says, oh, you've gained $40,000. I'm going to take 90% of that, because that's how they, tax summer earnings. And then, you start off the school year with less loan, or with, I'm sorry, less grant aid, mm-hmm. because they've decreased your grant aid, and with no money in your pocket because you have given it all to Harvard.
Yeah. And this is not a policy at all other schools. That's the kind of the clarification that you, in that video you sent me, she was saying this is only at a few tier something or other schools. What is...
Yes. So if this happens at, you know, the best law schools in the country, usually Harvard, Yale, and Stanford, okay. but Yale and Stanford don't take nearly as much of the summer earnings as Harvard does. And so it's more difficult for students at Harvard to be able to get by without taking on additional loans, because of this policy makes it so that you can't save any money during the summer to use as like your expenses for the year.
Do they tell this to you when you're applying? Is this something that anybody really knows?
No, it's on their website, but they don't tell people. In my conversations with them, they had trouble explaining the policy to me.
Wow.
I would calculate what my aid changes would be, and they're like, no, you're misunderstanding the policy. But then I'd ask, but are my numbers correct? And they'd say yes. So I'd say, how am I misunderstanding the policy if my math is right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I had many meetings with them, many conversations, many, many, many meetings. and they changed nothing. I think they added one extra line in like the frequently asked questions for financial aid. Mm-hmm. But did they prepare the first year students last year for this? No, mm-hmm. because I asked at the end, we had a meeting, and I'm like, what have you done so that students don't have to rely on older students to navigate this policy? And they basically said nothing.
Wow.
And so, yeah, everything that has come out since last summer, it's been because students have called out the policy. Mm-hmm. Students have explained the policy to each other. Mm-hmm. We have students changing their internships halfway through the summer because they realize they can't afford it.
Wow.
And obviously that has consequences beyond like financial. It's now reneging on an opportunity with your possible future employers.
Yeah. I caught that from, you know, the information you were sharing with me, is that there was like a thought process of, well, if I did 10 weeks, then I contribute this much to you. But if I actually only do 8 weeks, then I'm contributing less, so it might be more beneficial to do less time in the summer internship and then like get a job at, I don't know, McDonald's down the street, because you would actually keep that money, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like what is
well so this is initially how I found out about the policy. I was calculating my numbers, and I mm-hmm. saw that I was calculating how my grant would be reduced mm-hmm. based on the money I was earning. And I saw that if I worked 8 weeks, so Harvard has an 8 week minimum work period. So if you don't work 8 weeks during the summer, you have to, if you're on financial aid, you have to pay them a certain amount. Because they want to disincentivize people not working for the summer.
Okay.
Which, fine, makes sense. But you're only disincentivizing, you know, students on aid.
Yeah.
So at 8 weeks, I was like, okay, I'm basically not getting to keep any of my money, but I'm also not paying out of pocket to be working this job. So at 8 weeks, I was pretty much zeroing out where mm-hmm. I would get to keep nothing because of my grant reduction. But I also wasn't paying money out of pocket to do this internship. At 10 weeks, I was going to be paying out of pocket, where my grant would continue to get reduced, but I wasn't making enough money to make up for it. And so when I brought this up to Harvard Law and I said, you know, I've committed to a 10-week internship, but because I'm finding this out like 3 weeks into my internship, mm-hmm. I can't afford to do the 10 weeks. So I'm going to have to tell my firm that I can't complete the program.
Yeah.
And a lot of these programs, when they're in person, you meet with partners, you meet with lawyers at the firm, you network, you go to events. So they're really valuable weeks, especially the last one when you're mostly networking, right? And so not being able to be there for 2 weeks when the rest of your peers are there for 2 weeks, and mind you are all interviewing for a job. This is all kind of, you know, a rehearsal for what would be when you worked here.
That puts you at a disadvantage.
Yeah. If you're the person asking for accommodations, if you're the person saying, oh, I'm so sorry, I committed to 10 weeks, but now I have to do 8. Mm-hmm. You're the person that, you know, is being non-compliant or is being a pain in the ass to HR. And so like, if they have one fewer spot to give, they're not going to give it to you.
Mm-hmm.
But who's not complaining? It's the people who don't have issues with money, don't have to think about, you know, those last 2 weeks and do I go into debt or do I leave my internship early? And so Harvard Career Services, was going back and forth when I was like, hey, I need to shorten my internship. And they're like, oh, don't do it yet, blah, blah, blah. I ended up saying, you know what, I have to do it because you're not helping me and you're not telling me how I, you know, should go about this. And so what ended up happening was my firm gave me a signing bonus equal to the loss in grant aid that would happen had I, because I chose to work the 10 weeks. So I lost money working 8 to 10 weeks. And so they were able to, and so I had to take out a loan, another loan. And so they thankfully made it such that I would get a signing bonus that was equal to that money that I was losing so that I could stay. And also so that, you know, I could be earning the money I was earning.
Wow.
And that has been incredibly helpful now because obviously, like, I graduated and I'm not working till October because that's when my start date is. And like, I wasn't allowed to keep any of the money I made during the summer. So I literally have nothing.
Wow.
Like, I have a job interview at Trader Joe's on Monday.
Wow.
Yeah.
And that's kind of this rub that I'm talking about. Like, you are literally working, you're putting this effort and energy in, but you are not allowed to make the extra money that you would need to just live, to pay your bills, to live your normal life. Absolutely. Oh, it's even crazier in this example, because at least with student teaching and with the classroom, it was evil. It was evil. That was a Freudian slip. It was an even level playing field for everybody. So even the students that were in my program whose parents did pay for everything, they also were not able to work. But they didn't get to pocket money on top of that. That's the part I think is mind-blowing, that these students who are able to afford it can literally keep that $40,000. That's wild. That one article you sent me said some numbers like, Amy is not on financial aid, so she gets to keep $30,000, $40,000. And, you know, Jessica is on financial aid, so she gets to keep $9,000. Is it numbers like that? Or it's sounding like you're saying it was literally zero.
No, it's numbers like that.
Okay.
And the reason it's even $9,000 is because Harvard has $8,200 that it won't touch because that's your, like, summer living stipend.
Got it.
You can't live anywhere for $8,200. Not New York City, not DC. That is ridiculous for 3 months. So they're not keeping $82,000, but you're also spending more than that just to live.
Right.
And so I don't know where their $82,000 living stipend information is coming from. That's another thing we called out in our meetings, that it's just inaccurate. Yeah. And
even in Boston, you know, or Cambridge alone, that the rent over there is exorbitant. And then I'm sure if you're working in law, you have to also buy clothing to be able to go into these law firms and dress a certain way and travel to work.
And this is what we were trying to explain to financial aid. We're like, you know, yes, we are asking to keep this money, but it's not like to go, you know, to a concert. I'm not going on a European vacation. I'm buying interview clothes, you know, that I'm affording for the first time.
Yeah.
I am paying for my transportation. I am paying my bills. When I was having conversations with them, it was mid-COVID. My parents are both service workers. They hadn't worked in a year. And so that was an additional stress where I'm like, if I could keep this money, I could help my family.
Yeah.
Whereas like wealthy students are not only not thinking about that, but they also don't have the added pressures of having to contribute to their family financially. And so that was a frustrating part, that they kept saying, you know, your need has decreased because you've made $40,000, which literally it's true, but it's just not realistic. I think someone on Twitter called it indentured servitude.
Yeah, that was you sent me that person, and he's like now got over 133,000 followers. He's like a Twitter lawyer person.
Yeah, so he's the reason my tweets blew up, because he retweeted me, and he has a huge following, and I had no idea who this was, but then I'm like, oh, I see why people have picked this up.
How did that feel when that happened? What was it like watching these tweets go viral?
It was overwhelming. A lot of it is because I, you know, I had 50 followers at the time, and I was just complaining, right? But I was also like 2 weeks into my internship, and I was like, is this going to get me in trouble? Like, do I have to tell my, I ended up telling my firm, like, hey, this is going around in like the Twitter legal community, just FYI. Like, I didn't mention the firm. I'm just complaining about this policy.
Right.
And again, thankfully they said it was fine, but you know, at a lot of firms, that would be a big no-no because you're bringing negative attention not right. only to your firm, but to your school. And so, mm-hmm. again, I thankfully was at a firm that was willing to work with me, but there are so many potential consequences for a student in this situation to speak yeah. out. And I know I can speak out because I go to Harvard Law School and, right. you know, that means something. And mm-hmm. other people can't speak out because, you know, they're even more afraid of what could happen.
Yeah. That's what a lot of folks are saying in the replies, you know, or I saw that Reddit feed, but a lot of folks are kind of calling out the fact that you were at an Ivy and that those clerkships tend to make more money. So it was almost like people trying to call out this level of privilege. But obviously mm-hmm. you and I know that just because you're at Harvard doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, you're super privileged in general, right? You're like, you're trying mm-hmm. to achieve something by going to this school, which is probably why right. you picked an Ivy in the first place. And then you were just very shocked by this policy.
Also, I could afford to go to law school because I could get need-based grants. Mm-hmm. And that is exactly what Harvard promises. They said, if you get into Harvard Law, we will, you know, pay whatever you need for you to attend. Mm-hmm. I don't think my needs changed significantly throughout this time. The only thing that changed was we were in the middle of a global pandemic and everything was remote. And I, you know, had to buy a second monitor and things like that, which Harvard was fine with assisting with. But it was the additional things, like my mom works at an elementary school and it literally was closed for an entire year. My dad is self-employed and goes into people's homes and paints. Mm-hmm. And obviously that was not going to be happening during the pandemic. So it was these added kind of burdens that existed for so many low-income people and so many people of color, you know, that didn't exist for my wealthier peers whose parents probably, you know, or own corporations, can work mm-hmm. from anywhere, like yeah. are technologically literate and can, you know, handle, you know, this new world that we're jumping into. But mm-hmm. Harvard was unwilling to accept that in addition to the financial burdens that we have, we also have the burden of ensuring our families are okay and right. ensuring that our families can adapt to, you know, moving into a virtual space, mm-hmm. even for doctor's appointments. They couldn't accept the fact that low income and people of color were most affected by the pandemic because these are the people who can't take time off to work. Right. They didn't care about that. Right. They didn't seem sympathetic. They said these $40,000 should put you at an even playing field with, you know, your peers who are descendants of the Kennedys, which yeah. I always thought was BS.
Yeah.
And I told them that, but that's what they stuck to and that's what they're sticking with.
Wow, that's so right. What did your other classmates have to say? Because I'm sure they found out that these tweets were going viral, these conversations were happening. So what did they have to say to all this?
Well, my classmates who are similarly situated, so the, you know, first generation students, they were all like, oh my goodness, can you help me calculate my aid? Because, wow. you know, I need to know. Mm-hmm. Some of them cut their internship short. Wow. Some of them took on another internship. Like, people were acting in real time because they were for the first time recognizing that this was going to affect them personally. And a lot of people didn't know until I tweeted that because, you know, my group me blow up like, hey, like I saw this, like, can you please explain how this policy works? Mm-hmm. And for the remainder of the year, I kept getting younger students also who were going to be affected by the policy. Mm-hmm. And of course, I'm happy to explain, but this is also not my job.
Right. Like, yeah.
I gave all my money to Harvard. And on top mm-hmm. of that, they don't feel comfortable enough going to the financial aid office at Harvard mm-hmm. Law School. And so they're coming to me, right. which, like, fine. Like, of course, I'm happy to help. I'll explain. But also, like, Harvard, if your students can't trust your financial aid office, mm-hmm. maybe you should do something about that instead of putting the burden on the students that, you know, whose money you take
yeah.
to continue to explain this policy that makes no sense. And so
wow.
most students were supportive. I'm sure some students weren't, but it's also such, you know, it's a place where half the school is the top 1%, mm-hmm. 20% of the school is the bottom 1%, and it's just two different worlds. And when yeah. you see Harvard Law, you think everyone's on the same page. but that's not true.
That's not true at all.
It's a spectrum of privilege. Yes, it's a privileged place. I know what I stand to gain from, you know, going to a school like Harvard, but it's also a school that was not made for me and people like me. And when these policies are disproportionately hurting people like me, that's when, you know, you start to notice, okay, so these people have never thought about someone like me being in this situation where I need to work. I'm also helping my parents. I'm also, you know, need to think about health insurance because I'm not under 26 and can't just be under my parents' insurance if they had insurance. Like, these are the things they're not thinking about because they're used to catering to very wealthy white men who don't have these issues. And then wealthy women who don't have these issues.
Yeah. There's like two things that are standing out to me. First of all, these financial aid institutions, because I also had some issues at Harvard, financial aid within the ed school, they don't understand what it is to be generational in the sense that you are working on, you know, moving up and elevating in your career so that you can support your parents. They see generational wealth, you know, obviously coming from the top down. We're kind of working up. So we're trying to make sure that we are doing better so that our parents can be better, right? Like, so they're not understanding that concept, because I think if your story came out and you were like, I have children that I need to take care of, people might have taken it differently than saying, like, I have to help my parents. But that's still family, right? And our culture embraces family in that way, where you're going to make sure that your parents are taken care of. Lots of other cultures don't embrace it in that same way. Also, when you, that tweet, the one you shared from me from the viral lawyer, one of the things that he responded, which I thought was really profound, was he said, yes, of course, you're working on, you know, building up in your career. I forget the exact verbiage of what he said, but he was like, the intention is not for this school to gut you dry in the process. That shouldn't be the issue. You know, it should be that you're going in here already. You're going into a massive amount of debt because you're going into law school. So now it's almost like they're poking at you and trying to see how much more they can bleed from you. And for what? For really, for what? Because you have this massive endowment of a school, right? There's so much money at this school. These other folks are giving tons of money as well. It's creating a really negative, insane cycle that disproportionately affects people, low-income people, people of color, probably. It's horrible.
Yes. I know what you're talking about in reference to his tweet. It was like, instead of allowing these people to make strides in terms of, you know, decreasing the difference between where your peers are and where you are, instead you are basically what the Harvard Law School, and it seems like the Harvard Ed School financial aid policies are, is they're all about equality. No interest in being equitable at all. So it's like, oh yes, everyone pays tuition, so of course you have to pay tuition. And I'm like, yes, but I also don't have a trust fund, and also you advertised your financial aid as need-based. And then, you know, your idea of need is not realistic at all. Because what is a need to me is, oh, like, my mom is ill, of course take her to the emergency, you know, room. I don't care how much it costs.
Most
of my wealthy peers don't have to deal with that. And when they do, I'm sure they can pay for it. But for me, that's going to be like, how am I going to make this work? And that's not something that they're willing to consider. All they would say is, you know, financial aid is not intended to cover family expenses.
He said, I found the tweet. He said, surprising number of Harvard defenders here. Yes, big law associates make great money, but the entire point of financial assistance for low-income students should be to help foster upward mobility, not bleed them dry as they move up. And it's absolutely true. You're doing the right things. You went to a school that's supposed to help you with your upward mobility, to eventually help you take care of your family, but they're sucking the money out of you. Like, you know, it's like almost rattling you for change at a certain point.
And I think part of the problem is, I think now I'm recalling more of the responses, and people are like, why are you going to this big law firm that like is horrible and evil? And big law firms have kind of a negative reputation for, yes, paying insane amounts of money, but also doing, you know, harming people and working in favor of corporations. So a lot of people, when they hear someone complaining about big law, they're like, well, don't do big law. Because you're contributing to the evil. So just don't, and your problems will be gone. Assuming that you can just transition into a public interest job, which pays one fourth what a big law position does. And it's not like you're just supporting yourself. Again, like, I'm going to be like, my mom is almost retirement age. Like, I'm thinking about how much monthly I'm going to have to give her so that she can like live her life without having to work until, you know, she's 90. Mm-hmm. So public interest wouldn't let me do that.
Yeah.
I just couldn't. I wouldn't be able to have a child with public interest if I wanted to, because there's just no way.
Yeah.
And so, yes, it's a choice to go into big law, but it's also a choice that a lot of low-income students have to make.
Mm-hmm.
Because, one, I have a ton of loans that right. I need to pay off. Like, my parents didn't pay my tuition. I have loans.
Mm-hmm.
And so that has to be my first thought. Helping my family has to be my first thought. Mm-hmm. If I want to have a family, also have to think about that. That would not happen in public interest unless I were married to someone who was making money. A decent yeah. amount of money. So yeah. yes, like public interest is great. I would love to do it. Can't afford to do it.
Right.
And I think an additional kind of punch in the gut is that students, regardless of their financial situation, so mm-hmm. someone who's getting zero financial aid can go into public interest work for the summer instead of a firm, mm-hmm. and they'll get a stipend from Harvard.
Mm-hmm.
To help them cover their living expenses,
mm-hmm.
Because Harvard wants to promote students going to public interest, which mm-hmm. is great, but you're also like giving a wealthy student money mm-hmm. to pay for their groceries over the summer while you are taking my family's
yeah.
grocery money to pay them.
Yeah.
And so it's, and they don't base public interest funding financial aid on how much aid you're receiving at all. They
yeah.
just, if you're public interest job, you got, you know, the $5,000. It's not a lot, but it's still more than what we end up keeping as low-income students going into big law.
That's so interesting. I also very fervently reject this idea that I think is like perpetuated through this conversation of like, if you're low income and if you're a person of color, because you have these values, you have to essentially like, you know, choose martyrdom. Like, that's
yeah.
kind of the conversation with teaching as well. Well, you decided to go into teaching, so you don't do it for the paycheck. You do it for the out. No, I also need money. And how
yeah.
are my how is my community going to become better? How can I invest in those that I care about if you are sucking me dry simply because I have morals and values in the work that I do? I absolutely reject that. And I think that I've strayed away from that, even with conversation about folks picking careers, where I used to say, you have to do the thing that speaks to your heart. It doesn't matter about the money, blah, blah, blah. Sometimes you have to do the thing that makes the money so that you can recontribute back into society. Those are choices
exactly.
that we're faced with making. So, you know, it's easy to point a finger at someone who chooses big law. And you know, I don't know too much about the law world, so I can't speak too much to it. I don't have a lot of opinions about it. But I do know that it's easy to point a finger at someone for making a decision where money is the goal. But it shouldn't be that we have to point those big fingers at, you know.
Yeah, because there are also other goals, like how many Latina partners at law firms do you know?
Right.
Like none. And why? Because most of them go into public interest. And
right.
the people who do go into big law, like it becomes untenable.
Mm-hmm.
This is a little bit off topic, but people were going crazy and Googling and celebrating Johnny Depp's Latina
mm-hmm.
Lawyer, Camille Vasquez.
Yeah.
Why aren't people telling her to go do public interest law? Like, she was promoted to partner after this
yeah.
this case. And I'm not going to get into that case, but,
yeah, that was a
you know,
disaster.
They're very, like, people notice her because there are so few Latina
yes.
lawyers who get any sort of publicity. And people notice Camille because she's, I literally can't name you another one right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that is also doing something for your community, is being the face of what you could be.
Right.
Like Camille Vasquez just made partner, and I don't think I know any other Latina partners anywhere.
Wow.
And so now I'm like, maybe I could be partner.
Yeah.
But you're doing the work just by showing up. Like,
right.
I was not supposed to be in any of these spaces. And so much of my work is just being there and not dropping out or not
yeah.
crying or not like defeating myself.
It's the idea of existence being resistance as well. And obviously we don't want
yeah.
you in a place where you're doing negative things, where you're hurting the community.
Right.
But sometimes we have to weasel our way into other spaces as well. I work in a nonprofit. And before that, I tried to do more community-based work. And I was like, I'm not making enough money. And I'm also
mm-hmm.
like keeping myself into this pigeonhole of just community, when the world the people who hold the power and wealth in this nation are white men. And to understand the way that things work, you kind of have to understand the way that they do things as well. Doesn't mean I want to emulate exactly what they're doing, but I want to understand it. But you kind of talked about your mom a little bit, and you had shared with me that work, that her work kind of led you to want to get into law. Can you talk about that?
Yeah. So my mom, when she first moved to the U.S., she was undocumented. She was working as a nanny in Beverly Hills, L.A. So she's working for a wealthy family. She was living in home, taking care of two baby girls. Her boss at the time was, now I know he was doing medical malpractice law, but at the time, to me, he's just a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And when my mom started looking into applying for her green card, he helped her. And so he wasn't an immigration lawyer, but of course he knew people who were. And so he helped her fill out the forms and took her to, you know, her appointments and was able to help her get, you know, that green card, which is so important for, you know, all immigrants know this, like, mm-hmm. it's freedom, right? Freedom to travel, freedom to visit your family back home. And so my mom was able to get her green card. And the two babies she was taking care of at the time were Stacy and Melissa. And mm-hmm. she ended up naming me after Stacy, obviously, mm-hmm. kind of as like an ode to that family and to, you know, what they gave us, which is, mm-hmm. you know, the freedom to travel, the freedom to move around without fear, the mm-hmm. freedom to know that I would one day qualify for federal financial aid. And so that, you know, I could try to get to college. That's something that many students don't have. Yeah. They know from the beginning, if you're undocumented, you're not going to be able to apply for mm-hmm. financial aid. And so why bother? Like, why not, you know, drop out at 16, start making money and working? So I think all of that definitely contributed to kind of how I grew up and the extent of freedoms I knew I would have and the benefits I knew I would have. And again, I know I'm coming from a lot of privilege. Mm-hmm. And even now I'm struggling, right? Like mm-hmm. having had all these amazing privileges that a lot of my Latinx peers don't have, mm-hmm. still it's been really hard. Still, it's been like me asking myself every couple of months, is it worth it? Is it worth it? Is it worth it? Yeah. And to assume that people want it to be harder or to like consider the fact that people want it to be harder is mm-hmm. just incredible because it's already so, so hard. Yeah.
So your mom worked in Beverly. I think I shared with you that I also was a nanny in Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
So that I was like, oh my God, that touches my heart because I had, I don't know what your mom's experience was like, but you said she started off undocumented. And I worked with lots of women who were undocumented Mexican mm-hmm. or Central South American women. And then met a lot in other households too. Cause of course you like, you know, you go with the kids yeah. or you just like, there's kind of circuits and things like that. And not in my circumstance, but in other houses, I would see when a lot of these women were being essentially abused. You know, they just weren't being paid very well, or they weren't just being respected in a certain way. It also made me laugh that literally 90% of children in Beverly Hills speak Spanish because they have Spanish speaking nannies.
Exactly.
Yeah. So that was an experience that made me laugh. But you weren't born in LA, were you? Your story took you somewhere else, or your mom traveled somewhere else before she had you, right?
I was born in LA.
Oh, you were? Okay.
So yes, I was born in April of 92. And May of 92, my mom's eldest sister passed away during childbirth. Because it still happens. Women still die during childbirth. There are still high-risk pregnancies, and that's something we should all care about, mm-hmm. especially now. So my mom's sister died during childbirth. The war also ended in January of 1992, so a lot of things were going on, and my parents were thinking about where they wanted to raise their two babies. And so mm-hmm. my brother, my dad, and I moved to El Salvador. My mom remained in L.A., and my mom would go back and forth between El Salvador and L.A., because, you know, if you have a green card, you can't, you know, be out of the country for a certain amount of time. And so we were living apart for 5 years, from literally 2 months to 5 years old. My mom was flying back and forth working in LA while my brother, my dad, and I were in El Salvador with our extended family. Mm-hmm. We lived there till I was about 5. And by that time, my dad has also gotten his green card through my mom. And we knew that to get a good education, we'd have to move back to the States. And so that's when we moved to the Maryland, D.C. area.
Okay. And you had shared that you considered going into the education field before going into law. Why was that?
Because teachers changed my life. I think at every spot that I think back, I'm just like, oh my God, that teacher, like the teacher who recruited me into my journalism class, I was like, oh my gosh, I guess she thinks I can write. Like, and I was interested in the news at the time. So I dove into that and became EIC of my high school newspaper. And then from that interest in journalism, I did a summer program at Princeton where a lot of professional journalists became my mentors and helped me apply to college and told me I could go to Princeton, and they were right. And mm-hmm. so when I got in, they're like, you're going, it's basically going to be free because I qualified for so much financial aid. And so that's why I was able to go to a really fantastic school mm-hmm. for free. I would not have been able to do that without these mentors who I found randomly telling me, like, these are the steps. You are already qualified. You just don't know that, and you don't know how to go about it. Mm-hmm. Because my high school counselor told me that if I, quote, wanted to aim high, I should apply to Brown. Oh. So she was like, don't bother applying to Princeton. I ignored her, and obviously I had these mentors who were like, no, you're applying. Mm-hmm. But for me, I was like, it's so easily could have not happened.
Yeah.
Or I so easily could have listened to my high school counselor. And so for a long time, I wanted to be a counselor so I could never tell kids, mm-hmm. you know, that that was impossible, and to like help, especially the students who are first gen or who don't have guidance at home, help them apply to college. And so that's what I thought I wanted to do. And so when I was living in Boston and I got a job offer at Harvard undergraduate admissions, and mm-hmm. I was like, what better way mm-hmm. to help kids apply to college than to know what happens inside the room where they make decisions. And so during those 2 years that I was there, obviously learned a lot and gained a lot of insight into the system. But also Harvard undergraduate admissions and financial aid was being sued at the time by Edward Blum mm. and Students for Fair Admissions. And that's mm-hmm. kind of the next decision that's going to get to the Supreme Court. I think they're going to decide whether or not affirmative action is constitutional, and I think we all know where that's going to go. But so that situation started happening, children separated at the border started happening, mm-hmm. and Trump was president, and I just felt like I wasn't doing enough in that little room, because I was helping 10 low-income students get into Harvard every year, which is great. Obviously, those are 10 lives that are changed. Mm-hmm. I truly believe that those students, the ones that have made it to the application process, are going to be successful no matter what.
Right.
It's the students that don't even get that far that I wanted to assist. And so I'm like, this, you know, little ivory tower admissions office is just not enough. And it's also frustrating because you're seeing how privilege works and how it harms students who work really, really hard. And then the news, all they talk about is affirmative action.
Right.
So I'm like, nope, can't do that. And decided to apply to law school. I volunteered a little bit at a mm-hmm. law firm first and then decided to apply.
Wow. That's beautiful. I talk about this a lot where I don't necessarily believe that the answer is going to an Ivy League school. And I'm sure you can agree on that. You know, when I was teaching, a lot of my students would be like, so shocked that I went to Harvard. But I shared with them, for me, I would have never been, like, because we had Harvard undergrad students who came into some of our classes in the ed school. Mm-hmm. And I got to meet a couple of them. And also, you just see the life on campus there. And I said, undergrad at Harvard would have never been a good fit for me. That's not a place that I would want to go. The problem doesn't lie in that. The problem to me lied in the idea that our society perpetuates that Harvard is not a place that would have been good for me. I needed to make that decision. It shouldn't be that mm-hmm. these ideas are being pushed upon us on where's a good fit. Like, we don't belong in a place like that. So it's beautiful to hear that you went to Princeton and that you had to also have this situation where you felt like you actually belonged there. You know?
Well, I didn't.
You didn't.
No, two things in response to your comment. So many of these Ivy League schools are different.
Mm.
And of course, like as a first-gen student who is just thinking about financial aid and being able to afford college, I'm not thinking about fit. I'm not thinking about like what's the culture of the campus I want to be a part of. I'd never left home. And so looking back, Princeton was not the right fit for me. It was the right fit in the sense that they gave me more financial aid than any other college.
Okay.
They were New Jersey. My family's from Maryland. So it was a good 3.5 to 4 hour drive.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a small campus. And I think all of that was very positive.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of culture, it's also, you know, the southernmost Ivy. So it's a little bit more conservative than other Ivies tend to be. Obviously, the majority of students are very wealthy, very white.
Yeah.
Princeton, New Jersey, there's not much going on. So all there is a school, versus a place like Brown. Now that I know the school a little bit better, like, you know, there are no majors. And so people can choose their own interests and choose their classes. And Providence is a much more diverse town. And the school just, there's just less of an academic pressure. And as someone who was coming from like a failing public school system that I attended my entire life, and then going to Princeton, which is number one ranked research university in the country. That was a lot.
Yeah.
That was a lot socially. That was a lot academically. That was a lot just personally. The challenge for me undergrad was just figuring out how to transition from, you know, what I'd been living for 18 years to this new world.
Yeah.
There were no white kids at my school. This is the first time I interacted with a predominantly white space. And so that's what was hard for me.
Yeah.
It wasn't so much, I didn't even think about the academics. Like, that was secondary.
Yeah.
I was just trying to like survive. I was trying to wake up and not drop out.
Yeah, you sound like what I would have, what I was trying to convey to the students, that like if I had gone to Harvard, I would not have been happy. Or not to say you weren't happy, but I would have felt like a fish out of water for sure.
And I did. And I think actually at Harvard I would have felt better than at Princeton. Now that I know what I know about the schools.
Right.
Undergrad, I think, is kind of very different.
Mm-hmm.
Part of the reason why I loved Michelle Obama's book is because she was talking about all these things about, you know, like not feeling comfortable anywhere except for the, quote, Third World Center, which now has changed its name. But I spent most of my time at the Carl A. Field Center tutoring and mentoring first generation students because that's what I felt comfortable with. And
trying to find your people. Yeah,
exactly. And so I have since, you know, made my peace with Princeton, but I truly believe it would have been like a harsh transition wherever I went, especially if I was going to go to a predominantly white institution. But I would have liked to think more about the cultural fit moving forward. And having experienced that, I knew how to approach Harvard. I'm like, I know that this place isn't for me. I know that I need to find people, you know, who I'm comfortable with, but also get out of my comfort zone and be friends with people who live a completely different life than me. Like at Princeton, I was only friends with low-income people of color because I was afraid of everyone else. And I was like, these people are going to judge me. They're going to, you know, I was so insecure. You're 18. And then here I was like, you know what? I'm a fully formed human. I'm going to speak to, or I'm going to be friends with whoever, you know, shares my values. And so I do have friends who are on financial aid, who are not on financial aid, who from all over the place. And I think that was really positive. But it was something I learned from my time at Princeton, where I did the complete opposite. And so, I'm also like shocked that I went to Princeton and Harvard when I think about it now. But it was, so much of it was luck. And so much of it was guidance. And that's why I wanted to do education, so that students wouldn't have to rely on luck. They could have the guidance. And I still think that's important. That's why I'm like very loud about certain things, just because the more you know.
Yeah, absolutely. It's all about giving that information. That's why I'm so glad to have you on here. Now, without coming from a place of regret, but do you think that knowing what you know now about these policies, about what it was like at Harvard, would you have selected HLS from the jump had you known all of this information?
Yes.
Okay.
Because although it was incredibly frustrating, schools don't get better unless there are people like me poking them consistently. And then my friend Velo, who worked a lot in the summer contribution issue with me, he, at the beginning of last year, recruited a bunch of first-year students and said, this is the program, we're leaving, they're happy we're leaving, you need to make sure this administration doesn't get off scot-free.
Right.
So I think the more you push, like Harvard Law School just changed its shield in 2015 because it depicted a racist family crest.
Yeah.
And like 2015 is nuts to me.
Yeah.
How long that had been allowed to stand, but it changed because people like me, who this place was not made for,
right,
and who can point out the things that don't make sense anymore and say, hey, can you change this?
Yeah.
Otherwise, we're going to scream about it until you get so much negative publicity that you want to change it.
Yeah.
But yes, I would still choose it because I feel like though it wasn't the best place for me, one day it might be a good place for a Latinx lawyer in the future. Maybe my kids. I don't know.
Yeah.
Because look at the composition of the court.
Right.
Yale, Harvard.
Yeah.
And knowing how powerless I feel right now in this moment, going back to the beginning of our conversation, I think, how would I feel if I didn't have the Harvard Law School?
Yeah.
Like, I'd be so dejected because here I know at least people will listen to me.
Right.
Whether they'll take me seriously, whether they'll want to help, that's up to them. Mm-hmm. But this name gives you a platform.
It does.
You know, I know that financially everything's going to be fine in the long run. It's a little tight right now, but it will be fine. It's more of like a, how can we make these institutions shift so that you don't have people like me going to Princeton and hating it, and you don't have people like you thinking you would have hated Harvard when you don't know, because that's all you hear.
Yeah.
We want people to see themselves in us, even though we're very sad, like to be there sometimes, like it's important to be there. Because as you said, like presence is resistance. And so long as I'm sitting in this room, like the dean can't write me off because I'm here.
There's two things that are really popping out to me right now. And it's like, we deserve access to this information. We deserve access to these spaces. And that's powerful. But the other part of the power is the knowledge that comes with understanding. Even being in the space doesn't mean, it's not a band-aid. You need to know, you need to know that you're going to be coming into a space where you're going to have to ask difficult questions. You're going to have difficult conversations. You're going to have to push things. And that's going to be tough, but you have to know that you're going to carry that on there. So it's like, for you going to Harvard, the thing that would have been most beneficial is had someone before you told you about this policy, and you would have been more prepared to push it in another way, as opposed to starting fresh and new and understanding all of this information. You guys, you just talked about you and your someone who was working with you on this program, your partner in that, telling these next generation of students, don't forget, don't let the administration forget we were having this conversation. And that's how things are going to be pushed. Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah. Slowly but surely, even if it's just you annoy them to the point that they just want you to be quiet.
Yeah.
Also fine. Mm-hmm. But I mean, this is where the conversations are being had, right? Like Harvard Law School produces half of Supreme Court justices. And so half of those justices were professors at Harvard Law School. A lot of their friends are professors at Harvard Law School. Like Elizabeth Warren lives down the street. There's so much there. Mm-hmm. And to deny myself all of that because the institution will not rise to the occasion is ridiculous. And I'm not going to miss out on that because they don't get their shit together. You know, sorry, I don't know if I can curse.
Yeah, you can curse. I really appreciate that. That's a beautiful sentiment to kind of like wrap it up with. Like, this sucks. It's trash. This is probably like the whole premise of the podcast. This thing is trash.
It's trash.
But we are the treasure that's going to come in and start to push this thing. Mm-hmm. And that's the work that we have to do every single day by just showing up and being who we are. I'm really, really grateful for you to share all of this with us. We have a couple of questions.
Thank you.
No, I mean, thank you. Yeah, we have. So this one's a good question. It kind of goes along with what you were just sharing. So someone wrote in and they said, I'm in a similar situation where there's a policy in place at my job and I really want to speak up about it. I'm nervous about the repercussions of speaking up, and I'm wondering if you have any advice on going against the grain.
This is always tough. I would say definitely know who your allies are within your organization. So if there's like, depending on what the issue is, go to like the one person who is responsible for that issue. For example, when I was you know, talking about the inequities with the summer contribution policy at my firm, I went to the chief diversity officer because I said, you know, this is something that will impact the diversity of students you are going to try to recruit. And so, you know, that seemed like a good starting point. And so I guess knowing or figuring out who would be best to talk to, that way you're not just kind of screaming at the void. And also make sure that you're protecting yourself, because at the end of the day, like, right, we don't want to get fired for saying what's right. So just make sure you're expressing yourself within the rules of your workplace. And if that means like no tweeting about, you know, the workplace, then don't tweet, obviously. There are ways to work within the system. And I think, unfortunately, like, that's one of the things that people look down on, like working within the system. Well, sometimes that's the only thing we can do, because like the system makes it so that we can eat and live. That doesn't mean that systems don't need to change. That just means like you're going to be uncomfortable, unfortunately. And that's not your fault. That's the fact that your company hasn't put in the work to understand that before you're having problems. So I'd say work within the rules and try to like narrow down a group of people or a person who would possibly be able to help, and then have, you know, them help you get that word out. So for example, what I would do is I would speak to someone who's mid-level and I'm comfortable with, and just like say, this is bothering me, and then trust that they could get that information anonymously to someone else. That also could work.
Yeah, that's really powerful. I've been in certain roles where the higher ups are really, really receptive to change and policy, and certain roles where they're not. And for me, I think a good fit is a place where people are very receptive. In the space that I am right now, my direct report, like the person I directly report, he's so open to hearing ideas and change and conversation. And that is a place that I'm going to be able to make a difference in the world because of allyship, right? Like, you have an ally who's like, yeah, let's do it. Let's make this change. Let's progress. But that doesn't always happen in certain places. So if you don't feel comfortable speaking up, it might not be, not to say that you necessarily have to quit, but this might not be the space where you're going to be a person who makes change. It just, you have to kind of see each situation out. My biggest piece of advice is to never speak without thinking through all the aspects of it. Take a moment, write it down, be really intentional with the words that you're going to say, who you're going to say it to. I think that's going to be your best bet. It's like taking a breath, taking a moment, right?
Absolutely. I'm bad at that, so I'm glad you brought it up.
I've gotten really good at that, actually. Like, that's something I've tried to work on, because I'm such a like off the cuff person, and I used to just snap. Now I'm like, let me think. Let me take a moment.
You're going to have to give me some tips after this.
Yoga. Honestly, I'm not even being funny. Let's go back to what you were saying earlier. I started practicing yoga and like learning all of the tenets of it. And I'm like,
Really? What kind of yoga?
I did yoga. I'm actually teaching yoga for quite a few years as well. Yeah. I used to go to Core Power. They have like nationwide. Core Power is amazing. It's so good. And I did the teacher training, and they just like really rolled us through the 8-limb path and all that beautiful stuff that really changed the way that I kind of saw the world and the intentionality I put behind things. Like, I used to put some of the tenets, like I would write it down, like Santosha means contentment. And so I would write that and put it on my desk while I was teaching, because I did it during, you know, while I was my first year of teaching. And it just, even talking about it right now, I'm like, I get calmer talking about it. Like, it really changed my life. Santosha is not contentment. Someone's going to yell at me. I'm saying the wrong words, but their contentment is an aspect of it. But there's also like, I was thinking of non-stealing. That's another one too. And they would say like, yeah, of course we know not to steal from people, but sometimes when you're late, you're stealing people's time. You're stealing people's attention, you know, like kind of thinking about just being a good human.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
interesting.
Changed my life.
I actually just got an email last week from Core Power saying that they're offering scholarships to like BIPOC people who'd like to do teacher training. And I was like, maybe I should. But now I'm gonna go back to that email.
Yeah, this might be your sign. If you do, we got to talk about it, because I love teacher training. I got trained in Obviously C1, and then I went to the next level C2, and I was sculpt trained as well. So
I can't do sculpt, but maybe one day.
it's so good. I actually used to hate sculpt when I lived in Chicago, but then when I went out to California and I was looking for something to do while I was moving, when I moved out there, I did the sculpt teacher training so that I could like make more friends, and I fell in love with
Oh,
it out there actually. Yeah, so
good for
it
you.
was interesting.
Well, I'll try it again. I'll give it
Yeah,
another try.
give it a shot. So this last question talks about the dynamic with working with white folks. We kind of talked about it a little bit, but how do your peers treat you and feel around you, more specifically talking about the white folks? And I know that it, you know, we talk about you being in law, in education, it's mostly white women also that I'm working with. So I have some thoughts on that, but what are your thoughts?
Know who you can trust. I'd say, most predominantly white institutions I inhabit, which just are most places. I have one or two at least, like white colleagues that I can depend on and whose values align with mine. And for example, a situation where I would feel very uncomfortable bringing up something like a racist incident or something that, management isn't thinking about because they're all white, I can sometimes pull aside my friend and say, like, hey, I don't feel comfortable bringing this up, but do you mind, like, would you? And I've had luck in that my colleagues have been supportive and they said yes. Or, sometimes we'd be on a Zoom call, someone said something stupid and she'd text me, like, do you want me to take this? And I'd be like,
Ooh,
yes, please.
love that.
So you can tag team, so it's not always one person, saying all the things. And I've been lucky that I've found those people. It's sometimes really hard to find those people. More than those people, of course, you're going to have people who just roll their eyes because you keep talking about things that they don't care about. But you know what? Like, get along with those people because we have to. But I'd say finding those allies, and it doesn't have to be like a friend group. It can be like one person, the one person like if something happens, they will actually be an ally and like step forward and say something on your behalf or for you. And I think that's really important.
Yeah, absolutely. In teaching, most of my coworkers were white women. But also in teaching, most of the ones that I tend to work with, especially in the communities that I was in, they're very progressive and caring, and like they have all of the best intentions, right? So I always felt safe around them in that sense. But I had a really one that I was very close with, and I remember telling her at one point where I was like, I like me and her had a like a friendship at a certain point, and I was like, I love you and you're a really great friend and I can talk to you about a lot and I don't feel burdened when you ask me certain questions like at all, and I love that you're open to asking me certain questions. So especially we were teaching like social studies and we're teaching reading, so she would ask me things and I would tell her. But I also said there are some times where maybe I don't want to answer those questions, and so I just need time away, which is how I explained the beauty of like affinity groups. So I was like, that's what it was when we were at Harvard, where we had our student of color orientation. And in that group of folks, we didn't necessarily have to have the same types of conversations that we would have when white people were introduced. So you just have to know when you're moving into each space. So I'm like, whenever I want to like remove myself from that space of answering these questions for you, it's not because I'm mad at you or I hate you or any of those things. It's just protecting myself and taking a break a little bit, you know, like taking a break from having to provide all of that context and information. I also shared in the teaching realm too. Like, there's going to be times where some of the students are more comfortable saying certain things to me because we worked with all students of color than they are with sharing things with you. And part of this allyship that you're enacting is to not be offended by that either, right? To like be understanding of that. And then to also be grateful when they are open to sharing things with you, because that means that you've created a safe space for them, you know?
Yeah,
So it's
that's
definitely,
great.
and just it calling, like not calling it out, but acknowledging it, there is gonna be something that when you work with white folks, there are different dynamics, and that's okay.
Yeah. Just like there's no color blindness here. That
No, doesn't
is not
exist.
a thing.
No.
So, acknowledge it respectfully and do what you need to do to make it work.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Well, I'm so grateful to have you on here. This was a really fantastic conversation. Like I shared, I was so excited because this, just you being in law, like you said, is really, really special and significant. And the fact that you are bringing light to this issue is huge. I'm so grateful for all of the ways that you've used your voice to do this. And I think about future
Thank you.
Latinas who are going to need to hear this. And I'm just grateful, Stacey. Thank you.
Thank you for having me on. I loved speaking with you this morning.
Thank you for listening to It's All Trash, a podcast diving into the trash world of education. My name is Sabrina Alice, and you can follow me at Es La Maestra on all socials. Our podcast is It's All Trash Pod on Twitter. Today we were joined by Stacey Menjivar. You can find her on all socials at Stacey Menjivar. Help support the podcast by subscribing to our Patreon. You can get yourself a cute little It's All Trash pin and even a shout out on the podcast here. See you next time.